The McIntosh Bay Complex near Laurinburg, North Carolina, contains several Carolina bays of high biological significance with high-quality examples of the rare Cypress Savanna natural community. Geologically, the Carolina bays in this landscape were formed by a high-density bombardment of glacier-ice boulders whose orientation hints at multiple extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide Ice Sheet 12,900 years ago. Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier-ice boulders that were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide Ice Sheet. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davias in the description of the video. Today we will review what has been written about the Big Cypress Meadow, which is the Carolina Bay in the center of this image. The satellite view shows Big Cypress Meadow surrounded by farm fields and some small swampy Carolina bays. Harry E. LeGrand, Jr. of the North Carolina Natural Heritage Program published an inventory of the significant natural areas of Scotland County, North Carolina in May 2005. LeGrand discussed the Carolina bays comprising the McIntosh Complex, including the Big Cypress Meadow. The report is written for a biologist, so I will need to illustrate every sentence to understand the report. The McIntosh Bay site contains a series of four clay-based Carolina bays of high biological significance. Two have high-quality examples of the rare Cypress Savanna, typic variant, natural community. Another bay is essentially treeless and is an unusual depression meadow variant of Cypress Savanna. A cypress savanna is a flat-bottom wetland, such as a clay-based Carolina bay, with dense herbaceous layers. A canopy of Taxodium ascendens cypress is usually present, but trees may be absent. The state's only location for the federally endangered Canbis dropworth, Oxypolis canbi, which has tiny five-petal flowers, occurs in one of the bays. At least 10 other rare plants are present. The bays are also critical breeding habitat for rare amphibians such as for eastern tiger salamander, Ambystoma tigrinum, and Carolina gopher frog, Rana capito. The 2005 document by LeGrand has a page that says, "For the protection of sensitive species, this map has been deleted from this document and is viewable only on the Department of Defense site of the DENICS website." Hiding the map was a futile attempt to protect the site. 23 years earlier, in 1982, Timothy Niffong had already made the report about the McIntosh Bay Complex site, and he had identified the coordinates of the location and provided a map. Moreover, Niffong wrote that the site had logging access roads, which was a bad omen for conservation of the site. Niffong's report says that this is the highest quality cypress savanna known within the state in the true sense of a savanna as a grassland. All of the loblolly pines, Pinus taeda, were cut out from the site except at its very center where the water was apparently too deep to allow access of the logging equipment during the winter of 1981 to 1982. Consequently, some damage to the site resulted from the cutting of several timber drag lines, minor ditching, and the cutting of canopy pond cypresses, Taxodium ascendens, which interfered with timbering of the pines. However, as a savanna site, the bay may actually benefit from the overall effect of this intrusion in the long run. These satellite images from 2013 and 2018 show that the eastern part of Big Cypress Meadow appears to have been clear-cut after 2013, and the little bay that was a grassland is now a lake. A larger image of Big Cypress Meadow today shows that the western part still has some trees, but the eastern part only seems to have a network of logging roads. What happened to the federally endangered Canbis dropworth? Where are the tiger salamanders and the gopher frogs? Did the Big Cypress Meadow actually benefit as a savanna site from the logging activity? People who care about the environment might be upset by the answers to these questions. We will now look at the geology of this site. A LiDAR image shows that Big Cypress Meadow is in a landscape of multiple overlapping Carolina bays. Using the law of superposition, we can determine that bay number 1 was emplaced first. Basins 2 and 3 were emplaced next. Their rims are clearly visible. Basin number 4 was emplaced on top of basin number 2. Finally, basin number 5 partially covered basins 2, 3, and 4. The five elliptical basins originated as inclined conical cavities made by oblique secondary impacts of ice boulders ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide Ice Sheet. Five ice boulders in the ejecta curtain came down in a specific sequence at an oblique angle of approximately 45 degrees. The major axis of the ellipse-forming Big Cypress Meadow has a heading of 137 degrees. Following this line should lead to the place where the ice boulder that made this impact basin originated. Surprisingly, a heading of 137 degrees leads to Lake Michigan and not Saginaw Bay. A heading to Saginaw Bay would be 158 degrees and not 137. This difference of 21 degrees is too big to explain as an alignment error. Out of curiosity, I checked the orientation of several Carolina bays near the McIntosh Bay Complex and found that their headings were toward Lake Michigan and not Saginaw Bay. I have been using Saginaw Bay as the site of the extraterrestrial impact based on the convergence work by Michael Davies presented at a Geological Society of America conference in 2010, and I have also verified that many Carolina bays have a heading toward Saginaw Bay. I went back to look at the 2010 paper by Davies and Gilbride. They used the alignments of an initial 40 Carolina Bay fields and generated great circle paths for visualization in Google Earth. This yielded a fuzzy triangulation locus centered at 43.5 degrees north and 89.5 degrees west. This is illustrated with a pushpin in the image on the right. A flight time adjustment of the crater eastward along latitude 43.5 degrees north, taking into account the Earth rotating 0.25 degrees of arc per clock minute, directs us toward the site of the extraterrestrial impact. Davies and Gilbride heuristically examined various geological depressions found along that transit and selected the Saginaw area of Michigan's lower peninsula for further analysis. However, a frozen Lake Michigan also seems like a suitable target for an extraterrestrial impact whose icy ejecta could have formed the Carolina Bays. A careful analysis of the Carolina Bays and other impact basins may reveal that there were several extraterrestrial impacts. In 2010, it was assumed that only one extraterrestrial impact was responsible for the origin of the Nebraska rainwater basins and the Carolina Bays. The wider availability of good quality LiDAR images may make it possible to determine if there were multiple impacts on the Laurentide Ice Sheet, perhaps from fragments of a disintegrating comet. This will require re-evaluation of the headings of the largest impact basins to look for multiple convergence points. The McIntosh Bay Complex is located 1,063 kilometers from Lake Michigan, which is assumed to be the point from where the ice boulder that made the basin was launched. The basin has a width of 746 meters and a length of 1,045 meters. The width-to-length ratio corresponds to an impact angle of 45.6 degrees. The diameter of the glacier ice projectile that made the basin is estimated to be 209 meters, which is one-fifth of the basin length. The ballistic equations indicate that the glacier ice boulder that made this basin was launched at a speed of 3.230 kilometers per second. It had a flight time of 7.84 minutes and reached a height of 271 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The trajectory was a suborbital space flight in the vacuum of space. The kinetic energy of the impact that made this basin was equivalent to 5.47 megatons of TNT, which would have caused seismic vibrations of magnitude 7.97. The combined energy of the five overlapping impacts was equivalent to 12.64 megatons of TNT. These impacts cover approximately 1.8 square kilometers, so the energy transferred to this area by the ballistic sedimentation of the ejecta curtain was 6.9 megatons per square kilometer. It is not surprising that megafauna fossils are not found in this region. Any flora or fauna would have been ground into a pulp by the high energy of the impacts. In this review of the McIntosh Bay Complex in North Carolina, we have seen how ecological studies of the bays and the occurrence of federally endangered species are not sufficient to prevent logging operations that cause drastic loss of habitat for many animals and plants. We also learned that Saginaw Bay may not have been the only source of ice boulders for the creation of the Carolina Bays. Multiple extraterrestrial impacts may have been involved. It will be important to establish that the Laurentide Ice Sheet covered the extraterrestrial impact sites with a thick layer of ice 12,900 years ago at the onset of the Younger Dryas cooling event and the extinction of the North American megafauna. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.